This video is brought to you by Captivating History. The Silk Road is the name given to a network of trade routes spanning the continent of Asia, from the Eastern Mediterranean to the Eurasian steppe to China and Japan beyond, evoking images of camel caravan convoys and nomadic merchants stopping at desert oasis towns. It's essential to recognize that ideas traveled along the Silk Road as well as goods. As such, the development of this trade network around 2,000 years ago, with its spirit of exchange, had a tremendous impact upon the known world and should be seen as a significant step toward a globalized world. The specific origins of the Silk Road as an entity are difficult to pinpoint. We know that China traded with the West during the Han Dynasty, which ruled China from 206 BC to 220 AD. The Han Emperor Wu sent Imperial Envoy Xiang Qian to make contact with Central Asian cultures, probably to find allies in the face of threats at home. Zhang's reports from his travels contained valuable information and spoke of the potential benefits for China of improved relations, both for commerce and as a learning experience. This helped in formally establishing a trade network in 130 BC. However, when contemplating the origins of the Silk Road trade network, we can go back further to Persia under Darius I's rule. Darius established links across Mesopotamia and into the Indian subcontinent, even connecting with traders in North Africa. Alexander the Great expanded his dominion over the region using this network, called the Royal Road, and further cemented trading ties. What became known as the Silk Road, usually associated with China, ultimately incorporated and built upon these foundations. For the next 1400 years, these trade routes enabled a mixing and mingling of cultures and facilitated the widespread exchange of goods. Roughly speaking, this was established as the Chinese Han Dynasty engaged and forged relationships with the nomadic tribes of Central Asia. With their help, trading posts were founded and became integral stopping points in navigating the challenging terrain, particularly around the region of the Bactrian Desert. Merchants and traders would not usually travel large tracts of the route. Instead, they transferred goods from one post to another via convoys. Therefore, it was more the goods doing the worldwide traveling, as opposed to the people themselves. So, what goods were actually exchanged? Well, silk was obviously a significant export from China to the West, as the country was the only one knowing how to make silk, and they kept this a closely guarded state secret. In China, the silkworm was used for many things, but its main interest for those in the West was as a refined, luxurious clothing item. Light and airy in summer, and offering warmth in winter, and capable of coming in various colors and ordained with beautiful patterns, it's easy to see why silk became fashionable. Wealthy Greek and Roman families had an insatiable desire for the product. The ancient Greek word for China is Ceres, meaning the land of silk. Some say that the financial implosion of Rome was in part due to the constant flurry of silver away from Rome to pay for Chinese silk. While the silk trade may have only affected the lives of the rich in the West, the popularity of silk had a considerable impact on the industry in China itself, and many Chinese peasants engaged in silk production to satisfy the demand. Besides silk, many other goods traversed the network, from spices from the Levant to precious minerals and gemstones from North Africa. Fruits and vegetables, livestock, grain, and leather and hides were also exchanged. The early Chinese envoys were amazed and impressed by the horses they saw in the West, far bigger and more powerful than the horses in their homeland, and so Arabian horses were a popular demand for wealthy Chinese. Technology also made its way west from China, with papermaking traveling from China to Samarkand and Europe. Some believe that the knowledge of gunpowder also came from China, before being refined and improved upon for warfare by Europeans. From these two technologies, it's clear just how the increased level of exchange could completely transform cultural and political history across a vast region. Whenever different cultures come together and interact with trade, an inevitable byproduct is that ideas are shared and spread. Whether it be philosophy, science, or approaches to art, language, and societal organization, where trade spreads, ideas spread. One of the most significant developments facilitated by this mingling of cultures is the transmission of religious ideas. Buddhism made its way into China through the first widespread concerted missionary effort in the 2nd and 3rd centuries AD. Buddhist monks translated texts into Chinese, and Buddhism assimilated across East Asia with Taoism, displacing more primitive forms of ancestor worship. The missionaries traveled along the Silk Road towns, becoming wealthier and gaining more political clout. As a result, through the first few centuries of the millennium, we see the founding of costly monasteries and the trading posts of Central Asia. The monasteries offered merchants a comfortable place to stay on their journeys. In this way, this reciprocal relationship between merchants and monks helped grow the trade on the Silk Road and embedded Buddhism within the culture of many of these towns. However, it's not only Buddhism that traveled along the routes, but sharing ideas also allowed for the diaspora of Jews, Muslims, and Christians, with these groups founding enclaves across the region. One unfortunate byproduct of the increased interconnectedness of the global population is that diseases were more easily spread. Evidence has been found that links the spreading of diseases like anthrax and leprosy specifically to the Silk Road trade. The most infamous example is the Black Death of 1346 that killed as many as half of all Europeans. It is believed this bubonic plague may have had its origins in the Central Asia way stations of the Silk Road, as infected rats traveled unnoticed within the caravans. Before that terrible plague in the 14th century, one Western traveler may have done more than most to inspire the aura of the Silk Road in the popular imagination. Marco Polo was a Venetian merchant who allegedly traveled across Asia and worked at the great court of Kublai Khan at the height of the Mongol Empire. His stories of the Orient have inspired generations of travelers to the East, and the story of his family's journey encapsulates the essence of the Silk Road. First, being merchants, the Polos were interested in making money through trade in spices from a trading base in Constantinople. Marco Polo's uncles had been to visit the Great Khan previously, and on this second journey bringing along Marco, were also bringing two Catholic priests at the request of the Mongol ruler. This is symbolic of the growing interest in ideas across the known world. Arriving in Kublai Khan's majestic, opulent palace of Xanadu in 1275, Marco Polo supposedly entered his service, perhaps as a tax collector. Again emblematic of this newly globalized world, this fit into the Khan's common practice of using foreigners from various cultural backgrounds to administer his vast empire. The Venetian traveled more throughout China and Southeast Asia for around 12 years before returning to Italy. Though highly embellished and perhaps even falsified in part, his stories give lavish descriptions of the Khan's palaces, along with the terrain, deserts, mountain ranges, and oases to be found along the Silk Road. The travels, as the book is known, certainly played a huge part in the romanticization of Silk Road travel. For a long time, we knew little of the specifics of Silk Road travel. The term Silk Road itself was only coined in 1877 by German historian Ferdinand von Richthofen. In 1900, a Taoist monk, completely by chance, stumbled upon a cave near the Chinese town of Dunhuang, finding thousands of ancient manuscripts inside. They revealed a vast amount of evidence about the so-called Silk Road, details of transactions, of languages used in letters, and other insights into the world of the interconnected network. Historians now prefer to use the term Silk Routes to reflect what we now understand to be a complex network of various thoroughfares. Whatever the specific nature of the trade network across the vast region, the influence can be seen and tracked even to this day. Even looking at the bustling marketplaces of Central Asia, where different cultures still come together to sell their wares, in different dress, with different features representing their background, we see a scene that has not changed much over the centuries' trade. Merchants exchanging goods, in the same fashion as they always have, having to travel through rugged terrain over long distances. A paved highway, partially connecting Pakistan and the Uyghur Autonomous Region of Xinjiang and China, is all that remains of the original Silk Road. While the United Nations had intended to sponsor a trans-Asian highway and railway in this region, this has not been completed, but it inspired China's Belt and Road Initiative. Such projects as this represent a global infrastructure development strategy under Xi Jinping's rule and are evidence of the concept's appeal. To learn more about the Silk Road, then check out our book, The Silk Road, A Captivating Guide to the Ancient Network of Trade Routes Established During the Han Dynasty of China and How It Connected the East and West. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook for free while still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.